Bună seara! În această seară avem un invitat cu totul și cu totul special. Este vorba despre ambasadorul Turciei la București. Turcia, o țară extrem de importantă în acest moment în arhitectura de securitate internațională, o țară extrem de importantă economic, o țară extrem de importantă din perspectiva turismului și a destinațiilor turistice pentru România și pentru toată regiunea și putem da cifre în acest sens, dar în primul rând o țară care a înțeles că are șansa să se dezvolte și să devină o superputere. În acest moment, Turcia este pe locul 8 în lume în ceea ce privește puterea militară, a 8-a putere a lumii din punct de vedere militar, este a 10-a putere a lumii în ceea ce privește cele mai puternice state din lume. Dincolo de puterea militară, este vorba și despre multe alte aspecte și Turcia ocupă locul 10. Turcia are 72 de milioane de locuitori, este una dintre, sau clar, cea mai puternică forță militară din regiunea în care se află împreună cu România, Bulgaria și celelalte țări, dar este cea mai importantă forță militară de la Marea Neagră. Este în același timp o țară care în timpul comunismului a fost, dacă vreți, acea insulă care nu a putut fi cucerită de către Rusia și nu a putut fi integrată în sistemul comunist. Este o țară care astăzi se pregătește să devină una dintre cele mai importante țări din lume. Nu top 10, ci poate chiar mai sus, în top 5, în top 3. Turcia poate și are acest potențial, iar România are un parteneriat strategic cu Turcia. Are două parteneriate strategice în regiune foarte importante. Este vorba de parteneriatul cu Polonia și parteneriatul cu Turcia. Parteneriatul cu Turcia este unul extrem de important pentru că include aspecte de ordin geopolitic, include aspecte de ordin economic, include aspecte de ordin care privesc securitatea în regiune. Cu ambasadorul Turciei vom discuta mai multe astăzi. Este nu numai o onoare, este și o plăcere să l-am invitat. Este unul dintre cei mai tineri, dacă nu chiar cel mai tânăr ambasador la București. Așa că Turcia a învățat, mai ales sub Erdogan, sub președintele Erdogan, că meritocrația este foarte importantă. Îl salut cu această ocazie pe ambasadorul Turciei, Koray, și am să schimb în limba engleză. Koray, dostum Koray, if I may say so.
Thank you.
You are my guest today. You are the ambassador of Turkey. I told our viewers you are a very young, even I don't know, maybe the youngest ambassador in town, and that your president Erdogan understood that meritocracy is extremely important in promoting people in your state. That's why Turkey became an extremely modern in the recent years, maybe not as much as you would want or some other people like other countries in the EU, but still you are becoming very fast, very modern, very efficient, and by far one of the strongest countries in the world and very important for Romania. I underline this aspect because we are our organization and of course also this talk show is extremely preoccupied by the geopolitical situations, is extremely preoccupied by who is defending the region, who is our partner, who are our partners, and Turkey in my view, and of course anyone can have any other view, is by far one of the most important allies that Romania must have. This is for sure also happening because I know we have a common committee, a bilateral committee at the ministerial level between the Minister of Foreign Affairs here and Minister of Foreign Affairs in your capital. We have the trilateral with yes. Poland, which is also focused on geopolitics and other issues. So the cooperation on the strategic partnership is very important. But yes. Let me welcome yes. you first, and
Thank
then
you.
Go to the serious part.
Thank you so much, Multumesc, for inviting me here. This channel has always been kind to us all the time. And as we see ourselves here as at our second home, we always feel very comfortable in the country and also in Realitate TV. Thank you for this hospitality.
Well, it is our honor, and just to show that I really care about the partnership with you, I wear also the,
yes,
the symbol of the friendship, yes. Romania-Turkey today.
Thank you so, much.
This is
for doing this, that gesture.
Yes, it's from the heart. So, yes. Let me ask you first before going to the serious stuff, because you are the youngest ambassador here. How are you? You are in Romania for some time. How are you? Dealing with Romania. How do you find Romania? What hobbies do you have? What strikes you to Romania? What is your impressions? Big impressions about some places, or it can be also negative, not necessarily positive.
Of course. Well, it's actually a challenge, but also opportunity to become an ambassador at a young age.
Yes.
The challenges are known. There's no need to count on them. You don't actually have a room to make major mistakes. Of course, major mistakes can kill anyone in a serious position. But when you are young, of course, this room is so and so small. So you have to be very careful, of course. But of course, there is also a positive side of it. First of all, I'm quite active in town, within our community,
yes.
With my Romanian friends and colleagues as well. I'm pushing my friends and colleagues at the embassy too much. because I'm not tired and I want them not to be tired as well.
Yes.
Trying always to think on projects, to make something concrete.
Yes.
So this is, I guess, the positive part. Whenever someone calls me from the Romanian government or from civil society, I'm on the other side of the phone. I don't say, well, I'm busy or I'm tired.
I noticed that.
So thanks God, there's a kind of also an opportunity of having been appointed to this important position at a young age. But I consider myself as being very lucky to be posted in my first posting as the ambassadorship to a friendly country, which we have strategic relationship. Of course, before going on political matters, I should underline that everywhere in Romania, and I underline the word everywhere, depending on, regardless of their political attitudes, their positions and etc., there is a welcoming attitude towards Turkey and towards the Turkish ambassador. With my colleagues everywhere in the government, at the presidency, at the foreign ministry, at other ministries, notably the Minister of Economy, for example, which mm-hmm. we are having a very heavy agenda.
The trade is very big. It's €6 billion
yes,
per year.
Yes, it surpassed yeah. €6 billion already. They are very cooperative with us. Anytime when we have issues, problems, they are right away there. And we are trying to solve everything very quickly in a positive manner. In terms of the society, I'm again so happy to be here. Life is pretty much similar to what I'm used to. Live. People are so engaging, so talkative, open.
Like the Turks.
Yes, they resemble us in that sense. They're full of energy and emotions as well in the meantime. And also they are so tolerant people here.
Yes.
Many people says about it, as you know. I also served in many other places, three capitals actually before, and see many other capitals and countries as well. But here there is indeed a kind of embracing the other and not pushing it away. The current president himself attests to that very fact that this is a country and a nation that is able to elect someone mm-hmm. who is from a different ethnic origin mm-hmm. to the highest position in this country. It's a clear testament.
Well, many of your leaders in the past, in the present, are not necessarily from one part of the religion. They were promoted if they were not
yes.
necessarily
true.
The majority, coming from the majority of your religion. Even the Kurds had important positions in your state.
Yes, of course. We have
in the past and the present.
Many high-level leaders at high-level positions from Kurdish origin and from other ethnicities in Turkey as well. That's
but
right.
Before speaking about this, tell me a little bit about the person, the Koray person. I mean, what kind of hobbies do you have? What do you do to relax? Because I understood you are very energetic. I'm also
yes.
the same. I could notice that you are that type of ambassador. We talk here about how are ambassadors, and I don't want to offend anyone, but an ambassador cannot do his job at all, and it can be very happy. Or he can be really active and promote his country. And you being the youngest ambassador, I noticed that immediately when we got in contact, and you are extremely active in the weekend. The people, you know, ambassadors avoid working in weekends.
Yes, yes.
But you did work in weekends. So I think it's a very good thing that your government sent here a person that cares about the partnership, a person that can make the difference, because you know your capital is okay, not very far, but far enough. And it's very important who is the leader of the embassy in Romania. But tell me, what hobbies do you have? What do you do besides being an ambassador?
First of all, of course, this is a great honor and privilege to represent this great nation here in this beautiful capital. So the responsibility is so heavy, and I have to live up with the expectation. So I'm trying to do my utmost to live up with that expectation. And that leaves little room for me for a private setting or life here in Romania. Believe me, during the weekdays, it's mostly work-related issues.
Okay.
But if I can go out with friends whom I met during work-related activities, then it is a social activity for me. But other than this, I cannot make any sport, for example, no other hobbies, because literally there is no time. Even in the weekends, we are either visiting a countryside, again, officially to visit our business friends and companies, Turkish companies as well, or compatriots here in different parts of the country. So it's a very hectic life. Normally, I'm an outgoing, outspoken person, but when you wear the hat, of the ambassador, of course, there are limitations to that. So I just push the brakes when I'm doing my official job, of course. And as you know, protocol is the gist of our profession in the diplomacy. I'm someone who doesn't like protocol, actually.
I could see that.
But I served in many positions before at the heart of protocol rules. When I was serving as chief of staff of the former president,
I wanted to mention
in Turkey, the protocol office was also under my purview. So regardless of the magnitude of the country, whether it's a poor country or a rich country, diplomats have a certain way of living. You know, you have a limo, a car, a driver, and a chef, and a residence, etc. But I only use them when necessary. At 6 p.m., for example, I'm calling all my friends, butlers and etc., saying, can you please go home, you know? I don't want to, you know, need anyone here, because there is no guest in the house, so I'll be in my private setting. So this is the life.
I wanted to mention this aspect about you, that at 37 years old, I think, you were the chief of staff of the president of Turkey, which is a very high position. Even in Romania, it's a very important position. But in Turkey, which is where the president has even more power than here, constitutionally, but the president, I mean, to be the chief of staff of the president at 36, 37 years old, and to such a nation, it's really a responsibility. So that's why our viewers should know that before going into discussions. Also, you worked a lot in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, again, as a chief of staff, very much on the Western side with the United States, NATO, but let's go over these issues which are more not necessarily personal, but regarding the person. And let me close with a joke. I hope you will understand the joke. You are young, you will understand it for sure. I was thinking that maybe in your spare time you watch movies with Mihai Viteazu. It was a joke.
Okay. I took it as such.
Yes, okay. Let's go now to more serious questions, and let's tell our people that, our viewers, that Turkey, if we look to the map, you are in a very complicated area. But as any other crisis, it's a big opportunity as well. You have as neighbors in the south, you have Iran, Iraq, Syria. So, I mean, it's really a very complicated area. You have Bulgaria, you have Georgia, you have Armenia. It's really, you are a neighbor with the forces, if I can see that. It's unbelievable what kind of geopolitical situation you have as a country. How do you see this as an opportunity or is it's a liability?
As you rightly put forward, it's both a great challenge and also an opportunity at the same time. When I was talking with my friends from some Western countries, especially when I was working at the UN office in Geneva, I was witnessing how particular matters they were interested in it, because the agenda was, let's say, comprising of four or five matters only. In our case, if I were a foreign diplomat in Ankara, probably I would die to understand what's going on, not inside the country, I mean outside the country.
Yes.
Because if you serve in Ankara, you can follow events in the Middle East, in Afghanistan, in the Black Sea, in Russia, in Caucasus,
yes.
in the West, etc. You can enlarge the list. This region has unfortunately been always complicated. What is lucky is that Turkey has always endured to challenges around this geography and has always moved forward. There were, of course, interruptions, especially mm-hmm. during military coups in my country. As you know, we had
yes.
Two hard and one soft military coups. But despite all these setbacks, the country moved slowly forward. And in the last decade,
yes.
as you see, there's a strong takeoff. To manage the challenges, we have adopted the famous foreign policy strategy of zero problems with neighbors,
mm-hmm.
as you remember,
mm-hmm.
About a decade ago. And we were so lucky up until the Arab Spring.
Peace and yeah. friendship. Yeah.
Whatever you have in the history, let's put them somewhere. And if there are issues that we cannot agree on, again, let's do not make them as impediments for future collaborations, just as we did with the Greeks, for example.
Yeah.
So we moved forward with many of our neighbors in a positive direction. Of course, the international setting and regional setting changes without our control, in our control, of course. So the events of Arab Spring has deteriorated our relationship with certain neighbors again, notably
mm-hmm.
with Syria.
Mm-hmm. Yes, especially.
With Iraq, there was also a term that we have a bitter relationship with the former administration there, but now, thanks God, it's going in a very positive direction
with Syria.
With the new administration.
Yes.
We are trying a very fine diplomacy and walking on a very tight rope to give right balance to each and every of our relationship.
What about Iran?
With Iran, we actually have a very long, stable relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Our border is actually drawn in the 17th century, early 17th century.
Mm-hmm.
And we had no major war from that mm-hmm. time on. The two nations actually represent two civilizations as well. The Persian civilization is a very old historical one.
Yes.
And they represent the center of Shia Islam in the world.
Yes.
Their culture is so rich.
Absolutely.
And we also have, coming from Seljukis, from Ottomans, and early on, a very strong culture as well. So there has always been interaction
mm-hmm.
Between the two countries. And recently, again, in the last decade, we are looking forward and moving mm-hmm. forward in our relationship with Iran.
I'm asking you this question about Iran because, as you know, Iran is a sensitive issue for the international community. And we will take a short break of commercials. But after that, I would like you to tell us how do you manage. I mean, it's unbelievable what you have to manage as a country. We consider ourselves to be to have complicated neighbors and complicated neighborhood and so on. But for Turkey, it's even more complicated. And that's why it's important to know how you manage all these relationships. Iran, it was on the blacklist of the international community. Now, of course, because of the new agreement, it's a new era for, it's
yes,
a possibility
of
a new era
yeah.
for Iran as well.
Exactly.
But I would like you to tell us after that, how do you manage and how do you see the relation with Russia, the relation with, which of course is not your neighbor, you have your own Moldova, which is Georgia.
Still, yes.
You have a buffer zone there, which is very small.
Yeah, yeah. But from the Black Sea, it's
but from the Black Sea, it's your neighbor already.
Yeah,
yes.
Along
how do you manage your relationship with Russia? How you because it's very complicated. You have many trade with Russia, many interests, but at the same time, you are the second largest army and in the NATO and importance important army in the NATO, and NATO it's in this moment considered a threat by Russia. So maybe after the commercials we can discuss also a little bit about this and go sure. with the other subjects. Publicitate.